Hi, I'm Amy. I'm here today with Matthew Cullen, the founder of the Portico Initiative. Hello, Matthew.
Hi, Amy.
So your company is a synthesis of three different elements. Can you tell me about that, please?
Well, we work with individuals, entrepreneurs, and business leaders to help them achieve more and to enjoy what they're doing more. And we do that using three different technologies. So we use neuro-linguistic programming, or NLP. We use timeline therapy as well, which is similar to NLP. And we use hypnosis, which I think most people are aware of. And some people have different ideas about what hypnosis is. But we're using the kind of hypnosis that allows people to achieve more, to be more successful, in sport, in business, and also to do their own healing work and their own habit breaking and things like that.
So why did you start the Portico Initiative?
That's a very difficult question to answer. I think that NLP, as soon as I discovered it, I realised it was my calling. I had such a powerful experience in all the trainings that I did as a student of NLP, all of the problems that I managed to release, the negative emotions that I managed to release, the things I managed to achieve as a result of studying NLP, and I realised that I had to share that with people. So I decided to set up a business that was not only teaching these technologies, but actively using them as well in a coaching and a consultancy framework. So for who is NLP completely brand new? Perfect. In that case, I think it makes sense to talk a little bit about how NLP came about. NLP's been around for about 40 years, and in that time, a lot of people have contributed to it. So it means different things to different people. And I think to really understand NLP, we need to start at the beginning, way back in 1975. And this is a time of wide trousers and big hair and the Bee Gees are jive talking. The spirit of the 60s is still alive in San Francisco. And two men are about to finish their book. And it's a book that will revolutionize the field of psychotherapy and at the same time usher in an entirely new field of human endeavor, a field that we now call neuro-linguistic programming, or NLP. And in many respects, these two men were very similar to you and me. But in one respect, they were very different indeed. You see, they both had a certain flair for acting as if anything is possible. They both had the ability to just trust that everything would be okay. And they both had the skill of suspending their disbelief long enough to find out what was really possible. And if any of you have children, you'll recognize this attitude as one that's familiar to your kids. Because if you were to remember being a child, and remember how you used to learn things back then, because you had this attitude, only you didn't call it acting as if. You called it playing or pretending. So back in 1975, our two men are about to complete their book, and the world is about to learn the secrets of the greatest psychotherapists. But it's not the first time that someone's attempted to formalize the structure of psychotherapy. So what is it that makes this book different? Why does it work where others don't? So what's interesting about finding the structure of something is that as soon as it's uncovered, it seems totally obvious. For example, we probably all believe that the world is round, even though in the not too distant past, we believed it to be flat. Moreover, we probably believe it in the same dogmatic fashion now that our ancestors believed it to be flat. And to challenge the round world doctrine now would lead to being ostracized from society, much like if you were to challenge the flat world theory in the 15th century. So the question is, why do we believe it's round? Because I don't know about you, but I truly do believe it to be round. And to an extent, that's because I have to believe that. There's no place in sensible discourse for round world theories or triangular theories or space hopper shaped theories or any other kind, just round world theories.
Some NLP practitioners have a much more organic approach. They simply teach on the day and they hope that the clients will retain the information. Although I think that you said you're going to do it slightly differently and you're going to enhance the longevity of the client's memory.
Absolutely. My experience of NLP is that something that the more I put into it, the more I get out of it. So I will always encourage anyone who studies with us to continue applying the techniques of NLP. The truth is that when you do one of our NLP certifications, you'll have a massive life-changing experience in those 7 days. And some people might think that that would be enough. There would be value in that that's more than what they have invested in terms of their time and their finances. But I don't think that is enough. I truly think that people should go out and they should use these techniques and they should continue to learn more about NLP. They should continue to learn more about their unconscious mind and to notice how it can be applied and to really concentrate on using everything that we teach them in every area of their life.
So I'd be right in saying it's quite a life-changing experience.
Oh, absolutely. No question. I don't know anyone who's been through one of these 7-day practitioner certifications who wouldn't say that it was life-changing. It's huge. It really is. I can't emphasize enough the kind of change that you can expect when you attend one of these certification trainings.
How will you ensure the longevity of the training scheme that you're putting forward for delegates?
We make a lifelong commitment to our delegates in that if anyone who ever trains with us phones us up and they want advice on using the techniques for their own life, then we're very happy to give it to them. Or they want advice on how to apply the techniques we've taught them to specific challenges in their business, then again, we're very happy to work with them around that to ensure that the knowledge that we give them is always available to them, they can always apply it. I think that there are some NLP training businesses that don't offer that level of support. And it's another reason why we decided to offer an accelerated format, which includes reference materials and includes a comprehensive home study program, which you can continually go back to after the course and continually brush up on those skills. Now, I can tell that you're a lovely bunch of people. You're the kind of people that hold doors open. And you don't get mad when little old ladies are paying for their shopping in Tesco's with bags full of tuppences. One, two, three. Oh my, is that a shilling? And I'm willing to bet that at some point or another, every single person in here has paid someone a compliment. Perhaps it was even a very carefully crafted and selected compliment. You know the kind of compliment I mean? Where you look at someone and you think, wow, I bet people never notice this thing about that person. I'm going to tell them how great that thing is. Only when you tell them, they act like you've just insulted them. They take your comment, they take your compliment, and they distort it into an insult. And then there's those times when you you tell someone something, and it could be something really important, or it can be something totally trivial, it doesn't really matter. You might say, don't forget to pick up the milk on the way home. Or you might say, "Mother, honey, my mother's going to come and stay with us for 2 weeks over the summer." It doesn't matter what it is. But somehow or another, that person manages to not hear you. It's like they just delete what you've said right out of their world. They don't remember, they don't listen. Whatever it is, the message doesn't get through. All of these things are very interesting from an NLP perspective because they tell us a lot about the structure of communication and the structure of subjective human experience. And I think I'll always remember what one of my chemistry teachers said to me when I was about 14 or maybe 15 years old. And we were talking over an experiment that had ended kind of explosively. And we were picking up the bits of glass and wiping down the benches. And she said to me something that I'll always remember. She said, in a sense, when you look at what's going on in the beaker, you're not observing the reaction. What you observe is the reaction to the reaction. You see how the reaction manifests. You hear the noise it makes as it does so. You feel the heat as it makes an entry into the world. But it's not possible to observe the reaction. So in a sense, you have to hallucinate the reaction from what you observe happening. Now, as she was saying this, I had the realization that she was trying to explain something else. What she was really trying to tell me was what makes the difference between the student and the scientist. So whereas the student is investigating the subject for the phenomena they've been told to find there, the scientist is investigating themselves for the reaction their subject provokes inside of them.
So Matthew, you can also work one-on-one for a truly tailored session.
That's right. In a coaching situation, we could work one-on-one with a client, either in business or in their personal life, to enable them to achieve more. That means that we'd be applying all of the techniques that we use and that we teach in the Portico Initiative to whatever specific challenges a client is facing, to enable them to achieve their goals, to enable them to put problems in the past, and to enable them to have much better relationships and to communicate much, much more effectively.
And how is NLP coaching different to other forms of coaching?
There are obviously lots of different approaches to coaching. The difference with NLP is that there are a lot of tools and techniques which don't exist in the other approaches. So when you do an NLP practitioner certification with us, you also get certified as an NLP coach. That means that you will learn things like the Milton model of language and the Meta model of language to enable your clients to literally break open the problems and the things which are stopping them from achieving their goals and to go on and achieve massive success. Other forms of coaching don't have those kind of tools within them. They have paraphrasing or they have active listening. They simply don't have the power that NLP does to enable an individual to, in a single session, create massive change.
So this is a program that would be applicable to individuals who have been successful in past pursuits and they want to try a new challenge.
Oh, absolutely. I think that coaching is ideal for people who are already very successful, but they want to step up one or two or three levels to become even more successful and to really find out what they're truly capable of. So we encourage people who are already experienced massive success in their careers or in their lives or in their sporting events or whatever it is, to really find out what they're truly capable of.
So you can be aware of your weaknesses and find a way to approach them whilst at the same time strengthen the strengths that you already have.
Absolutely. I think that that's critical to really understanding who you are as a person, is to know where your weaknesses are and know where your strengths are. What we can do with NLP is we can focus on both sides so that you become stronger in the areas that you're weak in and you come to truly understand your strengths. So this evening's about letting you experience a little bit of the power of NLP. And I think that the best way to do that is to just let go of your need to get it right first time. Because ironically, the best way to learn this stuff and the only way to ensure that you do get it right first time is to just trust that you are doing it right. Because this is the attitude that little kids have. They just get involved, they just do stuff. And everyone knows that the best time to learn a language is when you're a little kid. The best time to learn a musical instrument is when you're a child. Because children just absorb new behaviors and new attitudes and new skills, and they just take stuff on automatically at that unconscious level. Now, Tony Robbins, the great American performance coach, is fond of saying that the difference between absolutely massive success and a totally average performance is a tiny margin. In golf, the difference between the perfect contact and a totally average drive is less than 1 millimeter. The best public plastic surgeons in the world say that the difference between supermodel looks and butt ugly is less than 1 millimeter. In NLP, that 1 millimeter is that one belief. So when you choose to believe that the best results come from letting go of the need to get it right first time and just doing stuff, I guarantee you'll have amazing success with NLP. And learning NLP means that you'll be a better communicator. It means that you'll be more successful in the things you do. It means that you will achieve your goals more easily. It means that people will be drawn to help you, because inside of you, they will notice and recognize that something about you is very, very simple and very easy to interact with. So who's ready to learn some NLP? Yeah? Cool. So I believe that the foundation of rapport, the foundation of NLP is rapport. Moreover, I believe that the foundation of all good communication is rapport. And I think that we all instinctively know what rapport is. And we're all in rapport with some people sometimes. And we're out of rapport with different people sometimes. And it may seem as you go through life that there are some people that you always have rapport with, and then there are other people that you never seem to have rapport with. So you would be forgiven for thinking that in life there are some people that you're going to have rapport with, and yet there are other people that you will never, ever have rapport with, because you're simply not like them. You don't have the same beliefs and attitudes as them. You don't have the same experiences in the past. You don't have the same occupation and interest now. You don't have the same goals out in the future as them. So how could you possibly have rapport with them when you're so different from them? And that's an understandable point of view. But in NLP, we don't believe that that's the case. We believe that it's possible for anyone to rapidly and easily build rapport with anyone else. Because the fundamental concept of rapport is simply communicating, hey, I'm like you, so you can like me. That's what we do with our words. That's what we do when we discover that a person has the same beliefs and attitudes and values as us. That's what we do when we discover that they come from the same place or they're going in the same direction as us. So we just need to find another way to communicate that very simple idea. But before we get into that, let's talk a little bit about what rapport is. So, rapport. I would say it's a state of likeness and of liking. Would you guys agree with that? Okay, I'm going to put it up then. Would you agree that when you're in rapport with people, there is a certain feeling of trust? Yeah? I'm going to pop that one up as well then. Sense of connection. Cool. Let's have that one then. Anyone else? Perfect.
Rapport is the communication of that sense of trust.
Okay. It's the communication of this. And it's a state of agreement. Is that what you said? Anyone else? I think what we've got there is pretty good. I'd agree with all of that. And certainly from an NLP perspective, that's exactly what we are going to be learning to build, is all of these things. So a state of likeness and liking, be communicating trust, we'll be creating a sense of connection or a bond between two or more individuals. And there will be state of agreement as well. And we've already covered one of the ways that we can do that. Because one of the things we can do is communicate how we're like other people by telling them. So on this, I'm going to put down here, I'm going to put words. But there are other ways that we communicate with people as well. Is anyone here familiar with the research into body language that happened in the 1970s? Yeah, a few people here. You'll probably all be familiar with the findings of that research. So that research had the idea that, for example, if someone had their arms folded, it meant that they were resistant to you, they were closed off, they were not in agreement with you. In NLP, we say very often that that might just be because the chairs don't have any arms. So the way that we use body language in NLP is slightly different. We don't say that any particular body language, if you like, has any particular meaning. And because of that, I'm going to put a different word up here, and I'm going to use a different word to talk about that concept. I'm going to put the word physiology up here instead. So your physiology is everything that you're doing with your body. It's everything from the really big behaviors of, are you sitting down or are you standing up? Do you have your arms folded or are they by your sides? Is your head turned to the side or are you looking straight on? And it's also the smaller, less obvious details, like the rate at which a person is breathing or the expressions on their face or the gestures that they're making as well.
And Matthew, you also work with business leaders, so I imagine you work with teams?
Absolutely. One thing that we can do with a team would be to work with them to build a values statement for them, to elicit the individual values of the individual team members, and then stack those values up to create values for the team. We also educate the team members around how to satisfy each other's values and how to satisfy their own team values as well. Also, we would teach a team how to use or understand the other team members' meta programs so that they can communicate with each other better. And also, wherever we have two individuals or more than two individuals in a team who are kind of at loggerheads, then the techniques of NLP will enable them to gel much more closely and to work much better.
So there's a far greater scope for developing teamwork within the team.
Absolutely. I think that when we work with a team, either in a consultancy or a coaching relationship, what we always see is that that team goes off to achieve far more than anybody really imagined they could. So given that what we're trying to communicate when we build rapport is this state of likeness and liking and this state of agreement, how do you think we could do that with our physiology? Exactly. So you can adopt the same physiology as them. You can mirror their body language. You can match their body language as well. Very briefly, I want to touch on the difference between matching and mirroring. So if I was matching somebody's body language and I put my right hand up, they would put their right hand up. We'd be matching body language. We'd be matching physiology. If they were to put their left hand up so that it was here and it was as though it was a mirror image, then that would be mirroring body language, or mirroring physiology. Okay, is everyone with me so far? So you're absolutely right, that is how we create rapport using our physiology. And to give you an experience of how powerful that is as a technique, I'd like to do an exercise. And it's a very simple exercise that you can do in groups of two. And what I want you to do is to find a subject that you both agree on. And I want you to agree vigorously. Talk about this one thing that you both agree on. But I want you to mismatch physiology. And I want you to take it to an extreme and have fun with it as well. So if one person is sitting down, the other person can be standing up. If one person's got their hand on their hip, the other person can have their hand on their head. You can take it as far as you want. And I'd encourage you to do that. Have fun with it. Have a laugh. Have some smiles. That really is the best way to learn stuff and learn stuff quickly. Plus, it will make the evening go a lot more quickly and it will be more enjoyable for everyone as well. Does everybody understand the exercise? Okay, so 3 minutes. Find a subject that you agree on and talk about that subject. And then mismatch physiology. You can break out the chairs a little bit and get some space if you want. So go do the exercise now.
Thank you.
So, working in the same groups that you're in before, I want you to swap it round. This time, I want you to find a subject you disagree on. But keep it light. No politics, no religion, nothing crazy. And I want you to disagree with your words, but I want you to agree with your physiology. So match and mirror absolutely everything that the person's doing. So that's the big behaviors, like are they sitting down, standing up, and the smaller behaviors and their gestures as well. Just a tip with gestures, only do them when you're speaking, if you're matching the other person's gestures. Okay, so 3 minutes. Disagree with your words, agree with your physiology. Okay? Cool. So how was that? Yeah. What did you guys learn or discover?
Quite enjoyable talking about it, and you feel less tension and confliction during the conversation.
Great. Anyone else? Anyone discover anything, or anyone have any questions about that exercise?
Communication is more effective when you seem to have a non-verbal communication developed.
I agree. Absolutely. So, which one's more important?
Physiology.
Does everyone agree with that?
I think both.
Sure, but which one's more important? Because we already know that if we agree on the words, we're going to have rapport. But if we disagree on the words, but we still agree on physiology, we can get the rapport. We can get rapport with people we've never had rapport with before. Because we couldn't agree on the words. We had nothing in common with them before. But using this technique, being able to communicate likeness with them, do you think you'd now be able to build rapport with them?
What if they use a very close body language? If you mirror that, would that help?
You can, certainly. There's a concept in NLP of leading. So you can start off in the same body language as the person, same physiology. And then gradually relax your body language. If you have sufficient rapport with them, they'll follow you. Plus, they'll be in rapport with you, so they'll probably naturally relax anyway. Anyone else have anything that they want to share before we move on? And did you enjoy the disagreement when you were disagreeing down here, but you had the agreement with your physiology? Was that enjoyable? Did people enjoy? Yeah.
It didn't feel so serious.
Exactly.
Isn't intuition innate? How could we possibly build on our intuitive approaches, and also how can we work with the unconscious mind?
I think that traditional hypnosis has the idea that there is a conscious and an unconscious mind. And that when somebody's in a altered state of consciousness, a hypnotic state, what happens is the dividing line between the conscious mind and the unconscious mind is removed, and the two become one mind, if you like, and become much more powerful, and you can apply logical, rational thinking to processes which are normally out of your control. So hypnosis for working with the unconscious mind is extremely powerful. The idea of NLP is that you can do something very similar to what you do in hypnosis, but without the need to do a formal trance induction, without the need to work in altered states of consciousness. So NLP works predominantly with the unconscious mind and with unconscious processes. So most of what we teach in the Portico Initiative is about enabling people to use their unconscious mind and to recognize unconscious mind thinking so that they can be more successful, be more contented, and achieve a lot more.
In NLP, we say that every piece of information that comes into us through our five senses that we receive through our nervous system goes through one of these three processes. So we have deletion. We have distortion. And we have generalization.
What's so destructive on the message? Three directions to destroy a message.
Well, it changes the message, certainly. And I think if you've ever been in love before, you're already very familiar with these three processes. Because, you know, if you go back and remember being in love with someone, remember how perfect they are in your eyes, that perfect hair, the eye color you've always found most attractive, the way they walk, that laugh they make from time to time, that cheeky smile, that one feature you just can't resist. It's like the only person who will ever meet all of your standards is right here, right in front of you, right now. And you tell yourself that this is the person you've always been looking for in your heart of hearts. You feel that this is exactly the right person for you. And yet, the truth is, this is not the person you've always been looking for. But because you feel this way about them, because you are madly in love with them, you've distorted their features. You've changed them into the person that you wanted them to be. Maybe you were never really attracted to people with that hair color before. Or maybe people from that part of the world were never really that attracted to you before you met this person. But because you're madly in love with them, you change all of those things. You change what's going on the inside. Or have you ever had this experience? One of your friends is getting into a relationship with with someone that you don't think it's going to work out for them. Maybe it's just that they're not compatible, or maybe you think that this other person's not good enough for your friend. So you decide to, you know, have a word. And maybe that message isn't received with the same kindness with which it was intended. Because when distortion's at work, that's okay, because these things simply mean one thing to the lovers and something else to everyone else. But when deletion's at work, these things are gone. They don't exist. And why would you make up something like that anyway? What is it? Are you just jealous? Don't you want me to be happy just because you're miserable? Whoa. Suddenly you're in an episode of EastEnders. And sometimes these relationships do work. Sometimes they don't. Very often, though, they lead to this kind of thinking. I'll never date another redhead. I could never trust another British person in a relationship. Every time I let someone get close to me, .. Every time I let my guard down, such and such happens. I mustn't let myself get too involved. These are all examples of generalizations. And the fact is that sometimes the process of deletion, distortion, and generalization does increase our happiness. And other times it has the opposite effect. And that's actually because they're not designed to increase our happiness. They have another purpose. You see, these are the three processes by which we learn. So the more you learn about the process of deletion, distortion, and generalization, the more you come to recognize it in your own thinking and in the things you do, the more you will be able to take control of your life, take control of your communications, take control of your relationships, achieve the things you want to, and learn rapidly.
Is this a course that's good for people who procrastinate?
Certainly. One of the things that we teach on the NLP practitioner certification is the technique called chaining anchors, which allows you to take a state which is a stuck state, such as procrastination, and chain it all the way through to another state, such as motivation. So that as soon as an individual starts procrastinating, they immediately feel the spur of motivation, and they're motivated to go off and do whatever it is that they were previously procrastinating about. So it's very, very powerful for procrastination.
So let's say we were studying a certain subject. Can be anything, really. Could be in a business context, could be in an academic context, could be just a hobby, really anything you can imagine. So, for example, it's as true for salsa dancing as it is for studying law or languages or anything else. And the first one of these processes that you'd apply would be deletion. And the reason is a simple one. That otherwise would simply be way too much information for you to process. So in order to be able to deal with the world and the vast amount of information, you simply delete most of it. Let me ask you a question. What's the sensation you're currently experiencing in your left arm? My guess is that most of you weren't even aware of the sensation in your left arm until I mentioned it, because it wasn't relevant to your ongoing experience. So you simply delete it. You delete that portion of your experience which isn't relevant. Other things that aren't relevant are the color of the ceiling, the smell of the plants next door, the feeling of your hair on your head. They're not relevant, so they're deleted. But, and this is a big but, all of these processes happen unconsciously. Deletion's an unconscious process. So you're not aware that it's happening. And more than that, you're not aware of what's being deleted. But putting that to one side for a moment, once the process of deletion has occurred, whatever remains of the perceptions you have get passed on to the other two filters. Maybe we can look at generalizations next. So the process of generalization is where you take one or a few specific examples and you make them into a class or a rule. So an example of that would be all BMW cars are good cars. Does anyone here agree that all BMW cars are good cars? No. The question to ask yourself is not, is it true? The question to ask is that generalization useful? Because, now, I studied philosophy for 6 years at St. Andrews University, and I know that some of my lecturers would be horrified to hear what I'm about to say, but I'm going to say it anyway. The truth is completely irrelevant. The only question you should be asking yourself is it useful? So useful generalizations are the ones that allow us to learn. They're the ones that allow us to operate in the world without restricting our freedom or causing us to make bad choices in relationships and those kind of areas. In learning, a useful generalization might be, in Spanish, all words are pronounced the way that they're spelled. Now, do you think that that would be a useful generalization? Exactly. It's not completely true, but a very high proportion of words are spelled that way in Spanish. So if you do learn the pronunciation rules of the language, and you learn the spelling of a Spanish word, you can more or less pronounce it. English, on the other hand, doesn't have that. So if anyone's learned English as a second language, they'll probably be able to vouch how useful it would be to have that kind of a generalization for English. But of course, it doesn't work, which explains why we have so many poor spellers in English. Then we have distortion. Distortion is where you take something and turn it into something that it's not. So in the example of learning a language, in order to learn a foreign language, you need to be able to map it onto your mother tongue. You need to be able to do that translation. And the process you use to do that is distortion. So sticking with Spanish, the word tortilla exists in Spanish, and it's come to exist in English as well. But the meaning's very different. So in Spanish, the word tortilla has the same meaning as the word omelette in English. And in order to translate it correctly, you need to be able to do that distortion. Or another one from the French language, because I'm actually not sure if this is true in Spanish or not. But when you say next Wednesday in French, if that happens to fall in, if the next Wednesday is in this week, then it's the same as this Wednesday in English. And if it's in the following week, it's the same as next Wednesday in English. So to be able to do that translation, you need to be able to do that distortion.
And some people, they may be slightly concerned, would a course like this change their personality or make them a different person?
I don't believe that a person's personality is defined by their behavior. All that happens when you attend something like NLP Practitioner or Unchain Your Mind is that your behavior would change because you would have more control over it. You'd stop doing the behaviors which are causing you problems and you'd start doing the behaviors which cause you to achieve your goals. So from an external observer's point of view, they might say that your personality has changed slightly. But my experience is that from the individual who's changed perspective, that change is always a positive one. And it's always a change at the level of results rather than a change at the level of their own identity.
And do the skills that the delegates attain, are they possibly going to fade over time? Is there a way to ensure that it doesn't fade?
I think everything fades over time. The way to ensure that it doesn't fade is to continue pushing forward, to continue learning and applying the techniques of NLP. We can teach you timeline therapy, and we can teach you NLP, and we can teach you self-hypnosis, but if you don't use them, then ultimately, of course, the changes will start to reverse. You'll start to build up more negative emotions, because life's life. You'll always go through life, and you'll always have events which cause you to feel angry or sad or hurt or guilt or shame or whatever it is. What we give you is the tools to release that. So unless you use the tools, you're going to continue building them up. But if you do use the tools, you will always continue moving forward. You'll continue learning more about your unconscious mind just by using the tools. So I think that any delegate who attends our seminars and who's truly intent on making massive change in their life has all of the tools that they need to do it.
So I left a blank space here in our rapport building sheet. Does anyone want to hazard a guess as to what we should write here?
Beliefs.
I think beliefs are in the words because you need to communicate the belief in order to know what it is. Another way that we communicate beyond the physiology and just the pure meaning of the words.
The underlying meaning.
Oh, okay. I still think we're in words. Yeah, getting there. Tone, did you say? Yes, your voice. Your voice tonality, how you use your voice. Because there's a big difference between me saying the word really, and I say it very straight, and if I say the word really, because the second one's a question. And then I could say it the other way as well. I could go really. And that's a command. So if you've got kids and one of them says, "Oh, Daddy, do I really have to do it?" And you go, "Yes, really." That's a command. And again, these are broad brushstrokes, just to give you an illustration of how the voice adds context and meaning to the words. So I'm going to put voice tonality up on here.
But tonality functions without words, doesn't it? If you just go to music and you have
Don and Nuva, Dua and Mol. For example, Dua is much more cheerful and Mol is always more down, not negative, but the opposite of it being very positive, for example. Mm. So you have two options of going much more to the positive side, lighter side, light in terms of really light or darker.
Absolutely. And the other way that you can use your voice, which would be very much in agreement with what you've said, would be to put expression into it. I mean, there's a big difference between the way I'm talking now and when I was talking like this earlier. And that really changes the meaning of what I'm saying. When I said it angry, it communicated anger, even though the words were not that relevant.
Can you find an application in the non-verbal? In text messaging, how do you provide expression?
Smileys? So I'm going to put, to be consistent with the field of NLP, I'm going to put voice tonality up here. If anyone here is a musician, it's a misnomer, don't worry about it. But just to be consistent, I'm putting voice tonality. And this is the expression that you give to your words using your voice. And we're going to do another exercise to understand how important that is in just a moment. But who here has got an idea of how we might be able to communicate the same rapport-building message using our voice? Remember, the message of rapport is, hey, I'm like you, therefore you can like me. I'm like you, therefore you can like me. How could we communicate that with our voice tonality? Oh, exactly. But how would you do that?
Same place.
Exactly. So the voice is quite a... Oh, yes, of course.
Just mirroring body language.
Oh, we've done mirroring body language. I'm sorry. That's quite all right. But you'll get the opportunity to do this one. So, exactly. So we'd be trying to achieve the same voice tonality as the other person. But the voice is a complicated thing. It has a different speed. I can talk right up here really fast, or I can talk really slow down here. And I can talk with a really high-pitched voice, or I can talk with a really low-pitched voice.
You should know what you sound like, because you might be hearing something completely different from your ears.
Oh, okay.
I don't know what sound like my voice.
Right. That's a good point. And I think that when it comes to matching and mirroring voice tonality, or more specifically, just matching voice tonality, there is a simple strategy that allows you to do it. Because most people aren't aware of what their voice sounds like. And perhaps some of you are sitting there thinking, well, I'm sitting next to someone who's got a big booming voice, but I talk way up here, so how am I going to be able to have the same voice tonality as them? And there is a very simple way to do it. Because all of the tonality of the voice is dictated by where you're speaking from. So if you're speaking from way down here, you're going to be speaking slower and deeper and perhaps slightly louder. And if you're talking from your chest, where it's going to be a lot clearer, then if you're talking from your throat up here, where it's going to be faster and sharper and a higher pitch. So when you're matching voice tonality, what you're aiming for is to be speaking from the same place. It's the origin of the voice which gets you the rapport. And you may be thinking, well, I've already learned how to do it with physiology, and that's easy. And it's something I've been doing unconsciously all the time anyway. All that's happened is it's become conscious. So why would this be important? Seems like this is unnecessary at this point since I can do it with this. And the obvious place where this is useful is on the telephone, where you don't have this. So for the purpose of our exercise today, we're going to be making telephone calls. But they're a slightly strange telephone call that we're going to be making. So again, working in groups of two, and you can work with the same people or different people if you choose. One of you is going to be making the call, and the other person will be answering the call. And you're both going to say the same thing. So person one answers the call. Hello, Matthew Cullen speaking. Person two says, hello, Matthew Cullen speaking. You say exactly the same thing. Not what you say when you answer the phone, but exactly the same thing as the other person. So that you remove this.
That's quite, that's quite
What's the difference between coaching and consulting?
So coaching is generally with an individual. Sometimes we do coaching with teams, but it's generally a one-on-one relationship that we would have with an individual, where we would work with them over a period of weeks to firstly establish where they are and establish where they truly want to get to, understand what it is that's stopping them from doing it, and help them to release all of the problems that are causing them to not achieve what they currently want to achieve. Consultancy is where we would go into a business and we would work with business leaders to apply the specific techniques of NLP to the specific challenges that that business is facing. So that could be in the area of sales or in recruitment, for example. But that fundamentally the difference between coaching and consultancy is that coaching is with an individual and consultancy is with a business.
And since we're talking about NLP and business, perhaps we could talk about some specific applications of some of the techniques of NLP. And an area where NLP is really, really useful is the area of recruitment. So that can be from a recruitment agency perspective, it can be from an HR perspective, it can be from the perspective of a manager seeking to find the right candidates, and it can be from the perspective of an individual going to a job interview. And one of the particular techniques that we have in NLP which is useful for that is a technique called meta programs. Now, meta programs are very similar to what's going on here. They operate after the process of deletion, distortion, and generalization has happened. And they transform the information that we receive so that we can process it. And there's quite a few different meta programs, and different people have their meta programs set differently. And it results in a different set of behavioral traits, or possibly even a set of personalities. And I'm just going to cover very briefly one of the meta programs, and that's the attention direction filter. And I've picked the attention direction filter because it's simple. There are only two possibilities. So there's attention direction on self, and then there's attention direction on others. And generally, people go around operating from one of those two modes. In recruitment, it's useful to know whether or not someone has their attention on themselves or their attention on others. For a computer programmer to have attention direction on self is okay. But for someone on front desk, we really want attention direction on others. Because the attention direction on self person on front desk is too busy painting their nails to even notice you standing there. But how many attention direction on self people are there on front desk? There's loads. And the thing is, they'll never really be happy in that role. And they'll never really be that good at that role either. So the best thing for everyone is to find the attention on others person for front desk. And with the specific strategies and techniques that NLP has to offer, you can always find that attention on others person. And you can apply the same kind of thinking and the same techniques to other industries as well. So you could use it to find the best analysts or the best computer programmers for a particular project. You could use it also to understand how long someone will stay in a job. And you can use it to understand which of the candidates in front of you is actually ready and actually genuinely does want to step up and be a leader. Is anyone here in recruitment, or is anyone familiar with the Myers-Briggs type indicator? Yeah? Oh, we've got a couple of people. Cool. So the Myers-Briggs type indicator was a psychological profiling tool. It's a pencil and paper instrument that allows you to understand the kind of behavioral competencies an individual might display and what roles they'd be most suited to in an organization. And there were a few problems with the Myers-Briggs type indicator. It's too expensive. Managers don't really like it, and candidates don't really like it. Because there seems to be something inherently wrong with pigeonholing an individual and saying, oh, I'm sorry, just because of who you are as a person, you're not suitable to work in this role in this organization. But the reality is that we do have different behavioral traits. And some of those behavioral traits are more suited to some roles than others. So the question is, how could we possibly get the same benefit the Myers-Briggs type indicator provides without paying for it and without giving a candidate a written test? And the answer is metaprograms. And the great thing with metaprograms is they're free to use. There's no per usage fee. And you can elicit them all entirely conversationally. So just in the course of a telephone call, before you even bring a candidate in for an interview, you'd be able to elicit the metaprograms you've determined are relevant for the position and only interview the ones who have the correct behavioral competencies.
What are the benefits of timeline therapy?
So timeline therapy is a very powerful technique that was created in the 80s by Dr. Tad James, who's one of the original NLP trainers. Timeline therapy allows an individual to release negative emotions from events in the past, to release limiting decisions and limiting beliefs that they have which are holding them back, and also to create the future in a way that is very compelling and that happens very naturally.
Timeline therapy is a very unique program that you offer. What are the elements that could really give your clients the edge?
I think the benefits of learning timeline therapy are, for an individual, they're twofold. Firstly, you learn all the skills that you need to be able to consistently release negative emotions from the past and release the negative emotions that build up in your day-to-day life as well, so that you continually have a very low level of negative emotions in your nervous system, and to be able to set goals in a way that you consistently achieve them and to release limiting beliefs. These are all things that an individual can do in the privacy of their own mind on an ongoing basis. And it's a very, very simple technique to learn, but deceptively powerful. The other benefit to it is somewhat more difficult to explain, but I believe that installing the ideas of the NLP models and the timeline therapy model into your own thinking greatly empowers you to see the world much more for what it is, rather than the way that people tend to normally perceive it.
So, in effect, timeline therapy, could it possibly be a form of regression therapy?
I would say that it is a regression technique. It's slightly different from hypnotic regression in that the memories that you revisit using timeline therapy are not so vivid. Very often you wouldn't even be aware of what the memory is. You revisit them in a way that's completely safe, and I think that that's the real difference between timeline therapy and hypnosis and hypnotic age regression.
You know, they tried to ban hypnosis in America, in the Bible Belt. Wasn't that long ago. They tried to ban it, and they got quite a long way with this piece of legislation. And it all hinged on one thing. They just needed a definition of hypnosis. What is this thing that we're going to ban? So they tried to write a definition of the state that people go into when they're hypnotized, or the behaviors that they do, or the thinking that they have. And they worked, and they worked, and they worked, and they worked. But the only thing that they could get that really summed it up would result in a number of other things being banned as well. So driving would have to go out the window, because you can't drive consciously. If you remember your first driving lesson, how did that go? I mean, if it was anything like mine, it was a disaster, because you sat in the passenger seat thinking, it's pretty easy. I've been driving for 18 years. I've been watching people drive. There can't be any difference, really. I know you push that pedal and it goes faster. You move this thing here and that changes gear. Easy. Oh, crap. Now I've got no idea what I'm doing. Because there's so many things that you have to do all at the same time. And the reality is that consciously you can only do a small number of things. And there are different estimates. Some people say it's around about 7 or 8 things that you can do consciously. But you can do an unlimited number of things unconsciously. So I'm having this experience right now, which is that I learned to drive in 2009, I think, but I never drive. but to get all of this stuff here tonight, I had to rent a car and drive here using my sat-nav and answering the phone at the same time. And suddenly, well, of course, I've got hands-free. It's fine. But these are just new things that have to be added into the driving experience. They weren't on my driving test. They probably should have been, thinking about it, because they're things that everybody does when they drive now. But they certainly are an additional thing that I've had to learn to do, and I felt like I was a learner driver again. So driving would have to go. TV would have to go as well. Because you can't distinguish between being in a hypnotic trance and watching TV. They're the same experience. But then this was the real killer. They realized that they would have to ban church. So this particular piece of legislation was shelved. The fact is that hypnosis is a naturally occurring state. All the Milton model does is it enables people to enter that state. It's a state of active imagination. It's a state where things are more vivid and more enjoyable and more pleasurable. So using hypnosis or models of hypnosis in public speaking is a good idea, I think, because surely you want people to connect with you and to visualize what you're doing and to enjoy the experience. So that's what the Milton model does in the context of sales. Oh, I beg your pardon, in the context of public speaking. And since we're talking about TV, let's talk about how NLP and hypnosis is being used in the media and politics, because it is being used in the media and politics, especially politics. And if you think, who's the greatest public speaker in the world right now? Who do you guys reckon that is? Who's got a suggestion for the greatest public speaker in the world right now? No one? I'm going to go with Barack Obama. Who? Malala? Okay. Oh, okay. Right, yeah, okay, yeah, I'm with you. And another person who's fantastic is Barack Obama. Now, interestingly, he's the president of the United States of America. And you might call into question whether or not it's appropriate for the president of the United States of America to be using hypnosis during his speech. I'm certainly not suggesting that he is. But if you were to break down what he's doing from an NLP perspective, he's using all of the techniques that we teach to public speakers. And he uses them fantastically. And he's incredibly successful with them. Another person who is great at this, and putting his politics to one side, because I know that he's somewhat fallen out of favor with the media and with people in this country generally, is Tony Blair. He was fantastic at public speaking. And I'm not saying that he's highly trained in NLP. I am saying that if you were to break down what he does, then it's very clear that he's using the techniques of NLP to be more persuasive. And where do you see these TV politicians? Well, you see them on the newspaper, yeah, of course, but mostly you see them on the news, doing interviews and kissing babies and being reported on and giving speeches and all these kind of things. The news is another place where you'd probably think there was no place for hypnosis. You'd probably think that the news should be factual information and nothing but. But it's not. And there's different reasons why it's not. I think firstly, if you were watching a drama or a comedy program, and then it cut directly into the news, and it was all these facts and figures and horror stories, I think a lot of people would switch off right there and right then. It would be too jarring just to go directly into that. But the fact is, people watch the news. It's part of our entertainment experience. And one of the ways that they soften up the news is by wrapping it up in Milton model patterns. They wrap it all up in hypnotic language so that it goes in smoother. It doesn't jar you. And everyone connects with it as well. These facts and figures are no longer just numbers. They're things which have meaning to us. They connect with experiences that we've had in the past, and they create pictures and feelings inside of us, so we carry on watching the news. Now, is there a danger of being hypnotized whilst people are talking politics to you? I think so.
Please tell me about self-limiting beliefs.
So the particular model of NLP we teach has the idea that everything that's happening to you in your life at the moment, or at least the way that you're responding to those things, is the result of a decision that you've made in the past or a belief that you have which you've picked up in the past. What we have in NLP is a number of different ways that you can release those decisions or change those beliefs in the past so that simply things which used to be a problem for you cease to be a problem for you because you can apply the resources of hindsight to them.
Also, is it possible to move beyond deep-set beliefs that may have been set from a very young age?
Certainly. Any belief that you have currently, you can release using timeline therapy or one of the other NLP change techniques. So there's nothing that you can't change. There's nothing that you can't move beyond. Truly, you're only limited in NLP by your imagination and your willingness to make that change. Let's talk about the products and services that we actually deliver. And since mostly we've been talking about NLP tonight, I'm going to start with the one training which teaches you NLP. And that's the NLP practitioner certification. And in fact, it's four certifications in one. So you're certified as a practitioner of neurolinguistic programming. You're certified through the American Board of Neurolinguistic Programming, which we consider to be the one that has the highest standards. But more than just being certified in NLP, you'll also be certified as an NLP coach. So there's different approaches to coaching. The techniques of NLP allow you to do coaching in a way that's very structured. Because if you have a client that comes in to see you and they tell you something in their language, you have different language models that will tell you what the best response is in order to help that person to break that problem open or to understand what that limitation is so that they can move it to one side and continue achieving more and more and more. So the certification of NLP coach is great for anyone who's currently in coaching and great for anyone who wants to start coaching as well. Then we have timeline therapy. And I know what some of you are probably thinking. You're probably thinking, well, Matthew, I'm kind of interested in the communication side of things, but I'm not interested in therapy. Why would I want to become a therapist? And I know exactly where you're coming from because that was my thinking as well. But the reality is that timeline therapy is more than a therapeutic modality. Timeline therapy is a process that you do to yourself, ongoing. It's a process that allows you to release negative emotions from the past. It's a process that allows you to delete limiting beliefs that you've created in the past. And it's a process that allows you to create the future in a way that's very compelling and that happens very naturally. So it's a very, very powerful technique to learn. And then we have hypnosis. And we've talked a little bit about hypnosis, and I know that we've got a few hypnotherapists in the room. But for the people who are not familiar with what hypnosis is, I want to cover a little bit the distinction between what we teach and what some people do as hypnosis. So there are some hypnotists, stage hypnotists, if you like, who propagate the idea that hypnosis is about mind control, and it's not. So let me explain to you how a stage show works. Firstly, the hypnotist says, so who wants to come up on stage? And the most extroverted people in the audience put their hands up and come up on stage. The introverts don't do it. They stay sitting in their seat thinking, God, look at those idiots getting up on stage. Don't they know what's going to happen? Then the hypnotist
hypnotizes the extroverts. That bit is real. And he gives them some suggestibility tests to see how responsive they are to hypnosis. That bit's also real. And then he'll send back anyone who doesn't do exactly what he says. And he'll send back all the people who are too hypnotizable, the people who just go into a really, really deep state because they're not any fun. So what you're left with is a group of highly extroverted people who said, yes, I want to go up on stage at a stage show and make a fool of myself, up on stage at a stage show making a fool of themselves. So there's no mind control here. It's just they've been given the opportunity to do that. And frankly, most of them probably do it after half a dozen drinks on a Saturday night anyway. So the difference between that and the hypnosis that we teach is that we enable people to explore altered states of consciousness. It's a state that is similar to a high-performance state. So the best sportsmen in the world go into altered states in order to play their sport. Best tennis players slow the ball down as it comes to them, and perhaps they make it bigger. The best golfers, as they're doing this, they're hallucinating the green getting closer and bigger and closer and bigger until they can see the hole. It's only then that they drive. So that's the kind of hypnosis that we do on the NLP practitioner certification. You will be certified at the end of it as a hypnotherapist. So you will be able to go out as a result of this training and do things like smoking cessation, if that's what you want to do. And what we teach is much more than just a simple hypnotherapist certification. It ties in with all of this.
Also, can you please tell me about the short course you offer, City NLP?
City NLP is a training that we run in this building on Leather Lane. It's a two-hour training that happens in the evening, and it's aimed at individuals, entrepreneurs, and business leaders who are interested in learning how to apply the techniques of NLP in a business context. What we do is we teach one module from the NLP practitioner syllabus, and we teach it in a hyper-accelerated format. So part of it is me teaching from the front of the room, and part of it is interactive exercises that the attendees do to really install the strategies that are most useful in business.
So this for you, it's not just a business, it's a lifestyle choice that you fully have absorbed yourself in.
Oh, 100%. Yes, from the moment I first discovered NLP and I experienced the power that it has, that it enabled me to release the problems that I had in the past and create the future the way that I want it, I was completely hooked. And if you speak to any of my friends, they'll vouch for that, and they'll tell you that there was a moment when I went from being extremely depressed to when I went to being extremely optimistic and ambitious, and I started this business, and I've been absolutely dedicated to it from that time forward. So certainly, it's more than just a business to me. Yeah, it's my life choice.
But we do more than just training, because we use all the techniques that we teach as well. We use the techniques for coaching, we use the techniques for consulting, we train the techniques in business as well. So let's talk about those different areas, and let's start with coaching. Because I know that in some people's minds it's a bit foggy as to exactly what coaching is and what therapy is and what consultancy is or mentoring and whatever. So I'm going to make it as clear as I can. Coaching is where we work with an individual to enable them to achieve their goals and to overachieve their goals by a massive amount. Very often when people come in and they see us in a coaching environment, they have a kind of hazy goal that they want to achieve. Sometimes it's quite concrete, like I want to make an extra £1 million this year. And sometimes it's more vague, like I just want to be more successful in my business. So what we do is we enable them to understand, firstly, what is that thing that they're trying to achieve? And also, what will that do for them? So very often people come in and see us, and they have a goal, but it's not what we would say is ecological. If you were to look at the consequences of them achieving that goal, it maybe is going to cause an imbalance in other areas of their life. So this is one of the ways in which NLP coaching is different from other modalities of coaching, is that we look at the whole individual and the whole context of their life, and then we tailor our approach and to the coaching sessions to that person's particular situation. So coaching is almost always in a one-on-one relationship. Occasionally we coach teams as well. And the way that we would do that is to work with a team in an intensive session to elicit all of their values, their individual values, and then out of that to create values for the team, and then to educate the team members on how to satisfy all of those values, and also educate the team members around the other people's meta programs so that they would understand why they're doing certain behaviors, so that they're no longer at loggerheads, but they actually understand why one particular person always rubs them up the wrong way, and they're empowered to do something about it. So that's the way that we could work with a team in a coaching relationship. Then we have consultancy, which is very different from coaching, because consultancy is where we go in and we work with a business to apply the specific techniques of NLP to specific business challenges. So in recruitment, for example, we might go in and address or assess the needs of a particular department in terms of their staffing. So perhaps they have a particular shortfall in a certain area, or perhaps they have a very high turnover of staff in a particular area as well. And we would look at why that is from a meta-program perspective. And then we would enable them to implement a simple change which would be somewhat transparent in the context of the organization to enable them to fix that particular problem that they have. So finally, let's look at the shortest seminar that we do, which is the Unchain Your Mind seminar. Unchain Your Mind was where it all started for me. Because oddly, working in a bank in a tall building was my childhood ambition. I know it takes all sorts. And I achieved that. And I lived in a nice house. And I wore suits to work, and I was respected, and I had a job that I enjoyed. And I was miserable. And I couldn't figure it out. It didn't make any sense to me at all. How can you achieve what you've always wanted to achieve, and it makes you miserable? So I started looking about for other ways of achieving whatever it was that was going to make me happy. And I Googled a little bit, and one of the things I came across was NLP. The next day, there was an NLP introductory event happening, which I went to, and I've been hooked ever since. And as part of my journey with NLP, I did this Unchain Your Mind seminar. And this is what... I've already got one. This is what Unchain Your Mind does. You see, we go through life gathering up negative emotions. We experience negative emotions, and they go into the glass. That was only a little one. Oh, another event, another negative emotion. And it keeps on happening. Oh, that was a big one. We go through life, more and more negative emotions. It just keeps happening, because that's life. Life's life. Shit happens. Then we get to a point where there's no room left in the glass. And it overflows. So what Unchain Your Mind does is it empties the glass. But you might be thinking, well, negative emotions aren't really such a big deal. I can deal with them. Everyone deals with them. Or you might not. But let me give you a model of the impact that having a glass full of negative emotions has on most people's lives. It's a model that comes from Tony Robbins, but I'm going to use it. And he calls this the Crazy Eight. And on this side of the Crazy Eight, we have all the emotions that stimulate the nervous system. So we've got anger, fear, rage, manic, panic, phobia, and all of the other ones. Then on this side, we have all of the negative emotions that depress the nervous system. So we've got sadness, depression, guilt, hurt, hopeless, helpless. And as the glass is being topped up with all of these negative emotions, what we do is we go round the crazy eight. We start off doing all of this crazy stuff, the anger, the fear, the rage, the manic, the panic, the phobia, the anger, the rage. But then we get to a point where we just don't have the energy to do that anymore. So it takes energy to be in that highly stimulated state. So we start doing sadness and guilt and hopeless. But all the time we're recharging, 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 recharging. We get to here, suddenly we have energy to go all the way around doing all of this stuff again. Then we run out of energy and we have to go back into helpless and hopeless and sadness and depression. Then we go back into anger and fear and mania and so on. And then, just from a purely biochemical perspective, we make a decision at the unconscious level that we can't do that anymore. We decide we've got to get out. So just simply to change our biochemistry, we have to do something. That could be drink, could be drugs, sex, food, self-harm, any of those things. Does that sound familiar to anyone? So, if you could get out of this, if you could drain that and drain that, how many people here would go for it? This is what Unchain Your Mind does. Gets you out of the crazy eight so that you can set the direction.
Some people may hesitate to enroll on a course like this because they may have some forms of social anxiety. How would you ensure that you adapt your training to these individuals and make them feel included at all times?
It's very important to us that all of our delegates do feel included in the training all the time. And one of the things that we do to ensure that that happens is we, at the very beginning, we teach the individuals in the group how to build rapport, the specific strategies that can be used to build rapport. What we find is that when we have a group of individuals who are very good at building rapport with each other, become very trusting with each other. And those individuals who might have had some social anxiety before they walked through the door, very quickly find themselves in an environment where they suddenly have 10 or 15 or 20 brand new friends.
So you don't have to start ready. This course will make you ready.
Absolutely. I think that it doesn't really matter where you are in your life right now. The NLP practitioner certification trainings that we offer, and also our other seminars such as Unchain Your Mind, are perfect for anyone wherever they are in their life, because it will really move them on to that next level.
This is a lovely location we're in. Can you please tell me about this area?
Absolutely. So the room we're in is actually on Leather Lane, and you might be hearing some of the noise of the market being packed up outside. We chose this venue because it has an extremely nice energy to it. I think it's quite unique in venues in the city of London. Another thing that's really special about this venue is that it's actually run by a charity that works with individuals who are deaf or hard of hearing. So the staff here are all extremely lovely, and we know that the money that we put into the place goes to a very, very good cause.
think the best experience today was the exercises. I think they were explained in terms of what you were going to get from them quite well, and just the realization actually learning through doing was really good.
I love the unchain your mind. As soon as he said that, I thought, oh wow. And then as soon as he did the diagram, it kind of makes sense. And he said, has anyone else experienced this? And I wanted to say yes. I didn't, but I wanted to say yes because I have. And I that's when I woke up and I thought, wow, this is for me.
I think that the exercise that Matthew presented us to take part in were actually very good. They're very enjoyable. I felt I was building up some rapport rather rapidly with the person I was doing it with, which obviously must have been working.
I think he was brilliant, you know, it's very nice to see how he's passionate about NLP and how NLP changed his life as well. So, you know, it's a big inspiration for people who need help and they need to learn more about NLP. I think we should check him out.
I'd say that the best experience I had coming away from this event was learning about the importance of the use of voice in communication. And that will stay with me. That was a big takeaway for me.
Thank you.